So thanks once again for coming tonight. Today we have a great presenter presenting on Google BigQuery. Before we get into that, a few quick short announcements. So Cassandra Day is coming up in a couple of weeks, and actually next week, if I'm not mistaken. And in a couple of weeks, we have Strata Hadoop World in New York City. So if anyone is visiting Strata, I'll be out there, so you can, you know, we can come and get together in New York. Other than that, just want to hand this over to Byron, who is the current host for today, and he's going to talk a little bit about Rubicon. Byron, where? Oh, he's right here.
Hi there. Thanks, Subhash. Yeah, Rubicon Projects is really excited to be able to host Felipe again, and thanks very much for the hookup. For those of you who may be interested in the big data space and in some of the topics covered tonight, at Rubicon Project, we know scale, we do data in a big way. So if you're interested in any of the opportunities that we have for SQL on Hadoop and Java developers, Python developers, if you're interested in data at all, come and see me at the end of the presentation. I'll be over there in that corner with some business cards and some parking validation. I'm also going to, when Felipe gets started, I'm going to throw the guest Wi-Fi up on a board here so you guys can get on that as well. All right, without further ado.
So just before we get started, can you give a round of applause for Rubicon for hosting today's event? All right, so we're going to have Felipe from Google come and talk. Felipe is actually one of the main engineers on the BigQuery platform, if I'm not mistaken. So he'll come and talk about it and even give demos. And he's going to talk about his favorite football team and explain some of the World Cup statistics. Is that what he said? Predicting the World Cup? Oh, okay, no worries. So he's going to show us something different today. So thanks again. Like a round of applause for Felipe, and let's get started.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can you hear me? Is it working? Yes, excellent. Thank you. So yes, my name is Felipe Hoffa. Let me turn this on. Yes, so first, as an introduction, I used to be a software engineer at Google. They moved me from Chile to San Francisco 4 years ago. And 2 years ago, I switched to a developer advocate role. That's mostly a software engineer that speaks a lot. I'm allowed to be on Twitter, I'm allowed to post blogs, I'm allowed to come to conferences. And that's my basic job. I've been doing this all around the world so far, 16 countries. That one is outdated. It's now 16 countries, 33, 34, 35 events. And I want to talk about big data at Google, the tools that we give people. I don't know who here knows BigQuery. Frank knows BigQuery, yes. So we have some BigQuery users. Do you love it? Yeah. Well, I want to show you BigQuery, I want to show you Google Tools. First of all, thank you all for being here. I know LA, everything is very far away, so I appreciate you coming here. I came from San Francisco. Thanks to Rubicon for hosting. Thanks for Subhash for insisting for me to be here. Just a quick impression of big data. We are in a big data meetup. Who here works with big data? Yes? Who knows what big data is? So, yeah, a couple of questions I have. If you think how big is big data, you close your eyes and you think how big big data is. How big is it? Terabytes, petabytes. I love the displays behind here. Like, I'm looking at trillions of bits, trillions of impressions. Is that big? You know how we call big data at Google? Data. So yes, usually when I do my big data talks, I introduce what big data is. That is big, but today we can fit way more data than that in a space like this. So it's not really about size. It's not really about weight. In Spanish, we talk about weight with data, but this is weightless. When we put that in the cloud, there's no weight anymore. We don't see it. It's just a lot of information. So other people think that big data maybe is slow. This is a big data problem because it will take days or hours to solve, but it could take seconds too. Or big data problems are complex problems, but again, they could be easy. So the question I have today is, what is what big data was? Sizeless, weightless, fast, and easy. Another book? Okay. That slide doesn't work. Yeah. I don't know why the presentation doesn't work, but a lot about data. What's going on? The system doesn't like my slides, so we can skip it. But what I wanted to tell with this is, what is data? What has more data, the first row or the second row? On the previous slide, I have them in random order. Woo! Okay, but what I mean with this, we can look at data in different orders, we can count it, we can sort it, but at the end of the day, it's not about how much data we have, it's about the order, the patterns that we find in them. So, yeah, we can sort letters and count them, or we can get, with the same letters, with the same amount of data, we can get a recipe for chocolate cookies. So at the end of the day, it's not size, it's not how much data you have, but the ability to find things, patterns, instructions, and the ability to understand them. If you don't know English, this recipe is useless. Steps for big data revolution. Why do we have big data now? Why do we have all these numbers around? First, price. Price is super important. Hard drive used to be $3,500 for 10 megabytes. Yeah, this is from 1980. It's not that long ago. And now price is just going cheaper and cheaper every day. Access. I love this talk by Tim Berners-Lee. He invented the web, and when he declared that project a success, I agree with him. He came in front of everyone for his second big project, and he's asking for raw data now. People should be sharing raw data. That also will change everything. And governments are sharing data now, institutions, etc. And speed is super important. If you find a data set and it takes 5 days to download, you'll be there. We have a problem. Or if you have to send letters to data. Dear data, I have this question. And you have to wait 3 days, 4 days for an answer. That's a problem too. What are we doing at Google? First, this slide is outdated. This is the new one. I work now for an alphabet company. But back in 1996, search was solved. There were a lot of search engines. You remember that one too? They were all bad. And they were doing all the same. Until Google comes in 1998. Basically takes the same data as everyone else. It's the same web. There's nothing different here. Just the ability, the idea that Larry Page or Sergey had at the time of looking at the relationships between web pages instead of looking at the content. That was the PageRank algorithm, and that's how Google started, being able to take the same data, analyze it in a different way, and get results fast, and the results you were looking for. Anyone knows why it's called PageRank? Because it ranks pages? No, it's called PageRank because Larry Page invented it. That's a little trivia. So you can have ideas. Google needed to collect the whole web, and Google needed to create the technology to do this. And that's a problem we all have with big data. We need ideas. We need data, and we need the technology. Luckily, today, 2015, it's much easier to get data, and it's much easier to use technology, because as Google is doing, other companies also are sharing their technology, so you can focus just on the ideas. These are a lot of papers that Google published during this year. Bigtable was one of the, that's all, how to store a lot of data. Now it's a service, Google Cloud service, so if you're using HBase or you're using Cassandra that are based on that paper, you can switch now to a Google managed service. Same with Plume, Java, and Illwill. These are our new MapReduce optimizations. Plume optimizes the workflows. Illwill shows how to deal with streaming data. And we package it both in a product called Dataflow. But my favorite product, the one I focus mostly, is Dremel. This is how to analyze terabytes of data with SQL. And it's packaged in a product called BigQuery. BigQuery is fast, analyzes terabytes in seconds. You only need to know SQL to use it. It scales very easily. No expenses, initial expenses. You just go and use it. There's nothing to buy or configure. It works with Tableau, it works with R, it works with Python, it works with ASP. My friend here, Frank Solomon, he wrote a very nice series of posts on how to work with ASP to be able to use BigQuery within a spreadsheet. He can tell you more about that. This is super nice. Instant sharing. If you have a data set, it's your data set, it's private. BigQuery is able to store it as safely as you need them. BigQuery is HIPAA compliant, it's ISO, whatever. So you can store private data. But when you need to share data, you can do it just asking BigQuery to share it with another person, a group, or with the whole wide web. If people have an account, they can come to BigQuery and instantly analyze whatever data set you are sharing. Today, I'm going to run some demos over public data. So if you want to run them too, to know that these demos are true, you can do it. And everyone has a free monthly quota. So there's a 3 terabyte of analysis each month for everyone. You can come and do whatever I'm doing here. So first question that I love asking is how many page views Wikipedia has? Any number? Page views in a month. Yeah, that's a good way to see it. It's bigger or lower? That number is in how much? Those trillions. I don't know how much time are. But any guess before I run for the actual number? 100 billion? A trillion? A trillion. That's a lot. Let's see. Let's see. Let's see. I loaded everything here so we can find. So I have this data set. This is a web UI that BigQuery has. And I have the page count for last year. I loaded also 2015. I loaded April, May. We can look at any. These tables have 5 columns. Basically, it says this title, this page, at this hour, had this many requests. In this language. So hour by hour for each page, we have the number of page views that page had. So it's not raw data, it's hour by hour data for each page. This table has 400 gigabytes of data, and it has 5 billion rows. We have more than 5 billion page views because this is summary. So here you can see in English, base acreage, at 5 a.m. UTC this day, it had 1 request. And to get the total, you know SQL, we can add them like this. Easy. We just have to go over 5 billion rows. And it takes, with the queries, 3 seconds, and the result is 20 billion. Fast, 20 billion page views. This is kind of fast to do. Now, I could have this number pre-calculated. So let's do something more fun. Let's run some regular expressions where the title matches any word, any random word. So we have blog. 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 Cloud. Love. Oh, that's nice. So let me put. Let's see what we get. Let's start with an L, anything else, and ends with a VE. How many pages we have during April? it took five seconds to go over 5 billion rows. We have 75 million. You might want to know which were these pages. So let's group by title. Let's get the title here, order by the first column in descending order. Let's get the first 10 pages. Any guess what would be the first result? The list of state universities in the United States. That matches the, I'm sorry for the fact that I can't read for you. LaTeX, Ludwig van Beethoven, Blake Lively, and I can't find Love, but Courtney Love, excellent. So we found Love in number 9 position with 200,000 views. It works. It's fast. Anyone can do this. But let's get to the next question. Here is how to load data in BigQuery. So can I do this live? People always want to know, where did I get the page counts for Wikipedia? And that it's open data. Wikipedia shares them here. Let's jump to September. Today is September 15th, 6 p.m. UTC, so a couple hours ago. And I want to download this. Let's see how fast that is. So today is September 15th at 6 p.m. And with BigQuery, I can run a command like this. Basically, this says, this is the table where I want to put the data. And this is the file I just downloaded. This is not a normal CSV. It's a space-separated file. It has no quotes. It has 4 columns. It's a gzip file. I will ingest a gzip file. Let's see if it downloaded. It will be ready in 30 seconds. So in this case, I'm taking live data. I've never seen, no one else has seen what this file has, but we will be able to process it in real time. But while it downloads, let me answer the question of how does BigQuery run so fast? So we have a little diagram. The first thing about BigQuery is that everything is in distributed storage. We don't have a data locality problem. Usually with other databases, with other clusters, you have to distribute data within your cluster with a partition key, with a store key. In BigQuery, everything is in the network. We just happen to have a very fast network. And for a query like this, we're looking at 2 columns. These 2 columns will be loaded in parallel from the distributed storage by many computers. How many? You don't care. BigQuery uses as many computers as data you have. So these computers start filtering the data, counting, grouping, and passing it to further servers down the road, up the road, and then the final server emits a result in as many seconds as you just saw. And this allows BigQuery to be very fast, as well as using column-oriented storage. This is all from the Dremel paper. If you put data in columns instead of rows, you're able to analyze it way faster. I can go deeper into that if you have any questions. Just interrupt me. I want to see if this downloaded. Yes. Now I'm loading the latest Wikipedia data. Yes. So column storage allows us to just go through the full column without loading the... So the question was just, in case you were wondering, why is it column storage as fast for analysis? Because if we want to see 2 columns, instead of loading the full record and dropping all the other data, we just look at the full columns we want to analyze. Also, it's much easier to compress this data because information tends to be more similar between its row. And the paper also describes how we are able to go through many columns at the same time. How do we move a pointer at the same time? That also allows us to have nested records. So for example, for one row here, I could have 5 rows in the other column, and we are able to traverse them at the same time to mix 2 columns. People always love interrupting me here and asking me, what about joins? I love interruptions, so please interrupt. Can BigQuery handle joins? And the answer is yes. So there is this project, just to run a demo, Freebase. Anyone has worked with Freebase? Freebase, no one? Freebase is a collection of facts, a knowledge base. It has 2 billion rows of facts extracted from Wikipedia and other sources. Facts like, this person was born here. This city has this many people, etc., etc. This person is famous for this. It's just triples of something, predicate is something else. And this project is no more. We are transitioning it. Wikidata is adopting all this data and merging it with Wikidata. But I still run these demos from Freebase. This, for example, is my query to get what's the median age on Wikipedia. So until people are 18 years old, we don't have many young people on Wikipedia, but it really jumps up at 24, 25. This is mainly because America contributes a lot of sports-oriented people. We can also find here the baby boomers. There's a big jump in famous people at that time. And there's another presentation I did with my friend Eva looking at the gender gap. We were looking, are there more males, women, or men on Wikipedia? And we started counting across countries, professions, ages, etc., etc. And we wrote this nice query to get the most famous women by country in the world on Wikipedia. So the question is, if you have Freebase facts, and you can extract every woman on Wikipedia and their age and their country of birth, their place of birth, how do you look for fame? Any guess? Sorry? Yes, page views. So I have a page views in a different table, and I can join both data sets. So I can take a query like this. Let me copy this query. Let me paste it here. And because I love looking at new data, this one loaded. It took 2 minutes to load the last hour of page views. Let me use that one. So basically, this query does, we're extracting every woman from Wikipedia. That's how you call gender in Freebase. Then we're looking at the Wikipedia ID. That's another fact on Freebase, so I have to do a regular expression here to look for the ID, extract that part, and then I need to join that. Once I do the change, I can join this on the fly. With my latest data set, that's 2015, September 15 at 6 p.m. UTC, and I can run this query, 2 billion facts versus the last hour of page views. That's a lot of data, but it ran in 5 seconds. I have no idea why Agatha Christie is the most famous woman right now born in England. It's her birthday.
Yesterday.
Well, that's awesome. Well, it's her anniversary, I guess, because she's not any older now, but yes. Ariana Grande follows Ellen Page. Angela Merkel, Marie Curie in Poland. You have pretty interesting results. They change hour by hour. I never know what I will get. But just because I love doing this, let me look at the CSV with data. Open with text edit. So I have CSV here. And my friend Eva created a map where I can take this data, paste it, and look at what is happening around the world right now. So this is Europe. Carmen Miranda, Zapataki, Emma Watson. Emma Watson was born in France. This map, South America, and Ariana Grande, Frida Kahlo in Mexico. So we are just able to go through a lot of data in real time, no pre-processing needed. Just go and query and do whatever you want and learn what is happening. Any questions? Yes, please. Is there a single repository that's a reference for all data? No. I've been doing my part of collecting it. I'm collecting a lot of public data on Reddit, and I publish it reddit.com/r/BigQuery. And whenever I find a new data set, I publish it here. But it would be so awesome if someone did the full catalog. That's yet to come. But I'll help me with that. Help me publishing data, help me sharing data and doing things. To get a little technical, so because Subhash asked me to go through technical details about BigQuery, how do we get to a position where we can do joins as fast? I like jumping back to 2012. In 2012, BigQuery had a lot of limitations. Each row, for example, could only have 64 kilobytes of data. That's a lot. That was my computer whole RAM 15 years ago. But today, a row can have easily 2 megabytes of data. You can store full Reddit comments there and analyze them. I've been doing that. Do you see any bottleneck in this architecture? Something that limits what BigQuery can do?
The mixer,
yes. Mixer zero is the last node to answer. That one is aggregating all data. So back in 3 years ago, the maximum answer that BigQuery could give was 128 megabytes of compressed data. Why? Because everything had to fit in that server. That's pretty cool. With big data, you usually want to go from unlimited amounts of data to usable data. You cannot understand, you really want to compress it to information, but sometimes you want to run ETLs. So the idea was to get rid of mixer zero and just send everything back to distributed storage. And that's a pretty good idea. It allows you to output as much data as you want. But the problem here is that data that is read by this node won't be able to be mixed with data read by this node. So now you need to figure out how to run groups or how to do joins. We fixed that by adding this keyword, each. If you have been using BigQuery, each is a way to tell BigQuery to run, the word just left me, to shuffle data on the first stage. So instead of reading everything straight into the leaf, we had some shufflers that look at, for example, if you're running a group, that send the data to different leaves based on your on this shuffling. This is a very expensive operation. You need a lot of networking, but Google happens to have a very nice network. We just published a lot about that, so data can be shuffled, and once data can be shuffled to different leaves, now you can run groups and you can output unlimited data. In this case, we are able to. Yes?
Thank you. This group each, since it seems like it's a little more expensive than a conventional group, is there an extra charge involved in that for the query or just Google?
Yes. Is there an extra price for group each? The answer is. Yeah, the answer is no. We don't charge extra. So, okay, a little bit of pricing with BigQuery. There are only 2 costs. It's more like 4 now, but essentially BigQuery charges for storage $20 per terabyte per month, and BigQuery charges for query. Each query looks at how much data you're reading. So it looks at the columns you mentioned, and it's $5 per terabyte read. Simple queries, complex queries, they both go through the same charge, except for that we announced last month that there will be more expensive queries when they are very, very complex. But I will go back to that and why in a few slides. But still, the model for 99% of the queries, 95%, is $5 per query, $5 per terabyte scan. So yes, that allowed us to output unlimited data to run ETLs. We also had this problem with joins. At first, we could not do joins. Then joins were limited to tables. So you could have a big table and a small table right next to it. And the small table could be up to 8 megabytes of compressed data that we copied everywhere. So that's an easy way to fix it. But now that we have shufflers, the shufflers can fix that situation, and you can do joins with big tables at both sides, just changing your join for a join each. That fixes the problem. 2 years ago, we also looked at how to stream data into BigQuery. Usually, you could only do 1,000 load jobs per day per table. That's one load every 90 seconds. But 2 years ago, we announced that you could do up to 100 rows per second of streaming data. That data that is immediately available. That limit today is 100,000 rows per second per table. So we could ingest that. I just love looking at those numbers. This works really well with the Internet of Things. We did a project where we had Moscone full of these sensors, and they were sending data second by second. We added window analytic functions. They are pretty cool to look at things that normally SQL can't do usually. I'll skip this sample for now, but I love window functions. We have the ability to calculate correlations. So for example, you can take two columns, sets of data, and see how it correlates to each other. With a query like this, I was able to predict airports, how late an airport might be. Or we're able, with the Internet of Things data, we were able to correlate what sensors were working with a similar pattern and what sensors were acting weird. 2014, more updates, SQL views. Now you can do views, table wildcards. If you want to query a lot of, do the union of a lot of tables, like month by month table, you can say, give me every table that starts with 2014. JSON, we're able to extract to navigate JSON strings easily, the streaming capacity. Joins keep getting better. Now you can do cross joins, left joins, inner joins. And now you are able to describe tables, decorators. A demo that I liked. We also have, for example, a data set with everything inside what that is happening with GitHub. So every operation on GitHub, you want to know what are the most popular repositories or people, etc. That's stored here. For example, April had 17 million rows, 40 gigabytes of data. And since GitHub has data that changes, the schema changes, we started, my friend Ilya Grigorik, he started storing all this extra data in one string column, that's JSON. If you want to query, you can run queries like this. In this case, I want to extract from the payload the language, and I'm grouping by language to see what was the most popular language, let's say, in August. And basically, in this case, I'm going through a string column, running a JSON extract on the fly. It was JavaScript followed by Python, Java, Ruby, et cetera, et cetera. And we can keep doing this. If you want to, that's all August. But if you want let's say, all of 2015. You can do you can run a table query that gets everything, every table that contains 2015. This has more data, but again, to go through all these tables to run JSON analysis on the fly should be pretty fast. 9 seconds. And yeah, JavaScript, Python, Ruby, Java are still the most popular. We just have more commits now. Questions? Are you still with me? We had more news last month. This was pretty cool. Our ability to run user-defined functions. If you cannot do something with SQL, now you can run JavaScript functions inside the BigQuery cluster. In this case, this example goes again through Wikipedia's data, and I'm looking at misspellings. What words are similar to other words running Levenstein distance? If you have more complex JavaScript operations, like running any JavaScript library, you can load JavaScript libraries, you can do, I've been doing language detection, sentiment detection, whatever you can do with JavaScript, you can load up those libraries and run your queries. And this is when pricing got a little more complex, because normally everything will be fast, but if you have a very complex JavaScript code, those queries might cost you double or four times the $5. But this allows you to write pretty complex stuff. Another news we had last month, I usually ask people what problem do they have with BigQuery. One of the biggest annoyance for people is trying to discover when to use each and when to not use each. Because now you have to add the keyword sometimes, and people are really annoyed by that. I try to explain them that this is a feature. We added each so they could do this join, so they could do these moves. But they are annoyed by it, so we announced that we are getting rid of that each. Now things should just run. That's a whole architecture change. There are a lot of real use case companies, startups, consultants. I've done a couple of videos about this. Whatever your domain is. I have like 20 minutes left. Okay, let's do this. There are pretty interesting data sets available. This is GDELT. GDELT is collecting every piece of news we get every day, every 15 minutes. It has 300 million events from the last 30 years, from 1979 until 15 minutes ago. And we are able to look at the news that are happening worldwide. So for example, if we want to see what happened in the last 24 hours, with this query you can draw a map. There's a blog post in this. You can also look at the last 30 years. So for example, I was in Brazil last month, so I wanted to see a timeline. This is the timeline of news for Brazil. We have way more news now after the internet started than before. But if you normalize this, you can get the whole story of Brazil from 1979 until now, and you can see it by month, when things were happening, when Brazil got the world's attention. I don't know a lot about Brazil, but I know about Chile. Three events here, any guess what these three events are? Yes, March 2010, that's an earthquake. What about the other two earthquakes? Youth. Hmm? Yes, that was 73. It doesn't go back then. But in October 1988, Chile voted to get Pinochet out of the government. And in October 2010, it was there. Yes, Chilean miners. You can see for any country, you can start digging in what the news were about, positive news, negative news, everything is typified. And you can see what is happening in real time and also to the past. This weekend, on Friday, Caleb released a new dataset with 3.5 or 35 with millions of books from the Internet Archive and this other project. So now you can go from books since 1910 until now, especially the old books. We have the full text available and not also typified. You can just learn from high history. Live data. This is a paper from a Googler on how to detect news that are happening from Wikipedia changes, from the changelog. So just to load his project, this is not the one in Heroku, this is an old project. But here he's able to look at every change that is happening on Wikipedia in real time. These are changes that are happening right now. And with this paper, he proved that he can find news by looking at clusters. Since the five occurrence of a page changing in the last 60 seconds between edits, with more than three concurrent editors. And this is not happening. These are possible clusters. This one didn't have three concurrent editors. He's looking at merging different languages. And whenever breaking news show up, they will show up here. And we are reading this with data flow. We are putting everything on BigQuery too. So if I want to know the news for the last 20 days, what was the top? Which pages had on Wikipedia a lot of changes during the last 20 days? I'm looking for things that are not changed by bots, grouping by title, by day, having more than 100 edits, more than 20 editors, and ranking the top one for each day. The top change today is the Wrestling Divas Championship. Yesterday was Malcolm Turnbull. 5 days ago it was Homo Naledi. Any guess what that was? You can just come here and search. Homo Naledi is an extinct species of hominin provisionally assigned to the genus Homo. It's one of our ancestors that was discovered. Very few days ago, and yep, it got a lot of changes, 300 changes from 100 people on Wikipedia. And you can just go through this very, very quickly and discover what is happening. I just love running these demos. The other part we're doing here is with data flow. Data flow is reading all these, the stream from Wikipedia, and it's sending everything to BigQuery. Just to mention a little bit about data flow. With data flow, you define your kind of MapReduce graph workflows. Data flow is able to run them. This one, for example, does an extraction for autocomplete. If you want to have autocomplete running in real time, for example, reading tweets, you could run a MapReduce like this. This is a parallel do how of extract tags, then we're able to count them, then we expand the prefixes and we get the top for language per key, and we are able to write those in real time and read them. And I want to run the same algorithm in data flow for the Wikipedia changes, but I haven't done that yet. If you write a data flow program with the data flow SDK, you can run those programs either on Spark or Apache Flink. They have runners for the Dataflow SDK. But we also have the service. So we can run this for you and auto-scale server. And you can see your flows running and splitting and how many rows are being processed at each stage. Yes, a very different sample. You know this place? New York? Yes, New York City. New York has taxis, a lot of taxis. 174 million taxi trips a year are taken in New York. The city open source opened this data. You can find all of 2014 and back, and half of 2015. This map was done by taking each of these points where someone was picked up and putting it on an XY chart. And suddenly you can see New York. with a query like this, give me all the points between this latitude, and the city shows up. And I wanted to know a little more. I wanted to know, okay, but for each of these taxi pickups, how long was the trip? Was it a short trip, a long trip? Does this change according by hour by hour? So I just ran this two-line code in Python, basically a SQL query that gets each point hour by hour and codes it between short trips and long trips. And if you draw those 24 images, you can see a living city, how things change hour by hour. And it's just amazing. And you can see problems. If you put attention to 4 p.m., the number of taxi rides reduces a lot. And this is because New York has a mandated 12-hour shift, and somehow everyone decided to make the shift change at 5 p.m. So all the taxis leave the city at that time, and people can't take taxis. And that's a real problem. We did this hackathon in New York at NYU with the TLC, and you can see this video later, where we were analyzing and looking for solutions. And I wish LA had the same. It would be very cool if LA opened this data and everyone shared open data. This visualization that I made got like 100,000 views on Reddit. And you know Reddit? Anyone knows Reddit? Yeah. Reddit also is sharing all of their... So Reddit has an open API, and a Reddit user in Washington downloaded all of these comments. I got these comments, I loaded them in BigQuery, and if you want to analyze all the Reddit comments from 2007 until last month, you can find them, the full text. I love running examples, so let me jump to my Reddit comments data set. So for example, if we wanted to see last month query table, how many comments we had, count star, this is the number of rows, this is simple, but let's see about subreddit, group by the second column, and order by the first, in descending order, the top 30. This will show us how many comments Reddit had, at Reddit had 4 million comments, followed by League of Legends. But sometimes you want to know more, like how each Reddit changed, how... So I wrote a query like... Where is my query? I lost my query, but just picture this going not only through 2015, but over the 7 years. I can run a table query here. Give me all of the story, and group it by month. And then you can load that data on, for the top 30 subreddits, you can put the data on a spreadsheet. This is a Google spreadsheet. And the Google spreadsheet have these motion charts that you might have seen. So for example, I want to have the average, I want the size to represent the number of authors that subreddit has, and I want the average score to be here, and I want the number of comments in this chart, and this is 2007, we have two subreddits, politics and gaming. Let me change the color of this. Colors will be my unique colors, and the size will be the number of authors. And then I can look at the last 8 years, how things were changing, which subreddits do more. This one is a subreddit that's way different than the other ones. It's getting way more comments, and IMA is getting way more average score. And you can just jump in this, look at how it's really changes, and do whatever you want with it. Yes. Yes.
Do you know his name?
Yes. I forgot his name, but anyone knows his name?
He does these wonderful graphic things over the last 20 years, and he shows the relationship of average birth rate versus income.
excited. Yeah, this Gapminder, exactly. The project Gapminder, in fact, was the one that brought this to fame. And this is the guy you're looking for. And his name, if I remember him, I can't remember him. But yes, I made a video and made this analysis based on his chat. Hans Rosling, thank you. Yes, he's my role model. Yeah, the spreadsheet, Google spreadsheets can do motion charts if you just throw them data in the right format. The format in this case, as you can see, was having the subreddit, the month, average score, authors, and comment. It draws a chart. And then you can do a video and be famous as him. I was also looking at clicks, subreddits that have the same authors. Like people that like PC gaming also like games and the PlayStation 4 or reaction war dude looks at trees too. Or this one got a lot more views because it has way more content. And you can look at how it's ready, what content it has. So for example, someone was asking, well, what's Reddit are trees? And I just did a full text analysis. And these are the top words that these people say that the other subreddits don't say. And I could do this with one SQL query. And now you know what trees is about. They are pretty cool dudes. They are stoned. They talk about friends, smoke, marijuana, weed. But they are like the happiest group compared to politics that talks about thunder, taxes, etc. It works. Last example, I have 5 minutes left. You can look at the weather for the last 90 years. This is Rio de Janeiro. You can see how LA has gotten way less rain every year. And this is super cool if you have users, you have geolocated data, you have stores, or you have app users that you know where they are. You can start running correlations and finding out how their behavior changes on a rainy day, on a hot day. If you can predict the weather, then you can predict your users' behavior. So the big question for me today is, what is big data? Was fast and easy if you could do all of this in real time? And it seems I can, so I hope you take these ideas and run with them. Shaquille is here. He's our strategic account manager for Google Cloud. If you want to talk with him, he would love to talk with you. And thank you for coming today. I love reviews. If you review this talk, I love it. Reddit, our BigQuery, I put every news I know about BigQuery there. Stack Overflow, we are always answering questions. Follow me on Twitter, Google Plus 2, if you have that. Thank you very much. Thank you. Any questions on the few minutes we have left?
Can you share the slides with us?
Yes, I have to do... I will send them to Subhash. Yes. Also, the video will be available. Yeah. Hello, people on YouTube. Yes, Subhash will annoy me until I send him the slides. Yes, please, John. Jonathan.
Yeah, I'm going to put you on the spot.
Yes, excellent.
There's a lot of stuff out there when you're trying to follow all the big data trends, a lot of different technologies and products and stuff. Could you tell us which products are most similar to BigQuery and why BigQuery is better?
Okay, the question is, what products are most similar to BigQuery and why BigQuery is better? There are pretty awesome products all around the world. There are a lot of products that have been implemented based on the Dremel paper. So you have Apache Drill, you have Facebook Presto. They all take the Dremel idea and have open sources their code. That's awesome. A big difference there is that BigQuery is not software. BigQuery is a service. So it doesn't matter sometimes how good your software is. You also care a lot about what's your hardware. And the networking that Google has is pretty, pretty good. So as far as I know, Presto cannot handle joins because you need really amazing networking there. But with BigQuery, you just don't need to worry about any of that. Now, if you want to run software on-premise, yeah, you cannot bring BigQuery to your house. You can bring that software, but that's a lot more headaches. What are your favorite products? Just to see how they compare. Try me. What are you using?
Actually, Felipe, can I interrupt a little bit? Any columnar data warehouse technology that you might be using, like a Vertica, for instance, would stack up right against this. If you've used things like AWS Redshift, this is where you'd compare it. The point Felipe mentioned where everything else is infrastructure. You're still dealing with nodes. You're still dealing with storage. You're still trying to optimize. You have to deal with backups and recovery and DR. This is a fully managed service. So you load your data, you run your queries, and you're responsible for paying bills. That's it. There is no other responsibility from an infrastructure perspective. So columnar data warehouses, OLAP type use cases where you need SQL, and you're mostly doing analytics and not transactions. That's where BigQuery comes in.
Yeah. This is a little dangerous, but I did this tweet today anyway. I saw this great post from, what's her name? Cake. They are in Orange County. I really want to talk to them. They are not here today, as far as I know. Anyone from Cake? They made this Redshift versus Vertica blog post. Read it. It's awesome. But I took it and annotated with my BigQuery idea. You can find this tweet if you want to see it. And I added a red cross with everything you don't need to do with BigQuery. Because BigQuery is zero ops, no servers, no pre-optimizations, no pre-sorting, no vacuuming, if anyone has done that, no planned downtime. If you have more concurrent users, it's not a problem. You don't need to size your cluster for the number of users. BigQuery is just elastic without you caring about that. So, for example, when they did their benchmark, they had to optimize things. None of this is needed on BigQuery. You have so many loading raw data. I can load whatever size of data I want. Loading a full month of Reddit comments takes me 2 minutes. I could do it here if you want. You don't need this to find a server setup. There are no servers as far as you know. No leader, no. The first query runs as fast as the second query. There's no cache involved. When you create tables on these services, you have to define a partition key, not a sort key. So you are only able to run queries fast as long as they follow that distribution. Why do they do this? Because you really want to get data into each node and not have to deal with the network, unless you have a super fast network, which we have. So you don't need that. They run this test over 2 billion rows. I really want to know what would happen with 20 billion rows. With BigQuery, the time would be almost constant. Not sure with a fixed size cluster. More optimizations like analyzing compression, not needed, no sort keys. They had to reload all their data, no vacuum, no analyze traffic, no whatever they are doing here. Of course, you can run your queries. They run it with Talent to compare data. There is a BigQuery connector for Talent. Things are faster on the second run with one of them, but things are as fast with BigQuery on the first and second query. I don't have the numbers yet. I would love to know those. Hopefully they will run the test. They didn't try joins. I would love them to try joins. They are worried about what happens while we're loading data. Things get slower? Probably. Not with BigQuery. How easy? They say it's super easy to manage these services because they're cloud services, but they wouldn't need to manage them with BigQuery. So it goes from easy to nothing. If you have your own servers, that's way more expensive. Yes, please take this challenge. This is, if you want to retweet me and if you want to keep me honest and run the benchmark, please do. I really want to see how it tests.
Well, pretty good answer.
Yay. And I did this today instead of preparing the slides.
Felipe, a question at the back.
One more? Yes, please.
So, my question is, I think software is great. Google
Google also has a history of decommissioning services. And if I were trying to build a large-scale data warehousing infrastructure, I would want to plan it at least 5 or 6 years out.
Yeah.
You know, how can I rely on the fact that Google might not make a decision that this is not profitable if we can tell everybody we're going to do it in 3 or 6 months or something like that? Mm.
Fair question. I still miss Google Reader, but the question is, will we have BigQuery 5 years from now? Well, we have SLAs, we have a contract of how long it would take if we wanted to take it off the map. But as far as I know, there are no plans. BigQuery is a product that we use internally. It's a product with a business model. And the worst that can happen if Google would disappear tomorrow is that you can take all your data out and use another database. But there's a tweet I have. Yeah.
So, yeah, I guess being the sales guy, let me talk about this a little bit. This is a different business from what you've seen from Google in other places, right? So when you think of Google Reader, when you think of other Google consumer products, they are not meant at enterprise customers, right? Mm-hmm. So the behavior in the market is different. We have to evaluate what the product offering is, and do we have something else which is better, and so on. And so the way product decisions are made is totally different from the way you do it with enterprises. With products like this, and then, I mean, BigQuery is one part of Google Cloud Platform. We've got infrastructure, we've got storage. We're dealing with large companies with deep pockets and lots of lawyers. Nobody's going to sign up with us if they believe that we're going to stop that service, right? So we've got contractual obligations. We've got, besides SLAs, we've got language in our contracts about the fact that we cannot even make API changes for a certain period of time before giving so much notice. This is a different business. Yeah. You cannot compare it to even Gmail, for instance, which is a core pillar of Google. But at the same time, it's not the same as selling to an enterprise. So in that sense, this is totally different, and the behavior you'll see from Google will be very different. You might have heard that, okay, Google doesn't have any customer service. Mm-hmm. Well, you haven't spoken to cloud customer service yet. If you sign up for a cloud customer service account, then obviously that comes with support, that comes with SLAs on response times. And depending on the kind of service level you have, you can get your responses back 24/7 around the globe, right? So what I want to emphasize is this is a different business. It's meant at different types of customers, and obviously Google behaves very differently in this space. David there mentioned about the investments we've been making at over $2 billion per quarter. Mm-hmm. The fact that these products actually run Google, I mean, these are externalizations of things we are already running. So it's not like we'll kill the product. Mm-hmm. It's already been in use at Google in production for years before we just externalized the API. So the products are not going anywhere. They're still being developed, enhanced, and refined, and will continue being used at Google. And Cloud Platform becomes an avenue for the rest of the market to use the same infrastructure that runs Google.
Yeah. So
hopefully that kind of answers the question a little bit. Yes.
Last question, please. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, you mentioned that this would be where you do like Vertica or Amazon. Mm-hmm. So I'm assuming you're sort of going after the enterprise market. Do you want to combine public data with corporate enterprise data? How do you do that in a secure
fashion? Mm-hmm. Yes, how do we handle security? And the answer there is...
In that scenario, combining public data with
compliance. Yes, so basically, on one hand, you have to trust Google. Then, to trust Google, there's a lot of independent auditors that big clients have send to our... Mm-hmm. Yes, so there is compliance here. There are important things that keep... to keep Google honest, and you have independent auditors. Your data is private. we have the contracts too. And also just to get into the cool side. So if you want to get all the certifications you need, we have them. If you need more, ask for them. There's also a pretty cool project, because I'm more of a software engineer than a certification person, is the encrypted BigQuery client. And this is pretty magical, because you could encrypt your data at home, put data on BigQuery, not share the private key with BigQuery, and BigQuery is still able to analyze it. Sounds a little magic, but it's homomorphic encryption. And if you are an encryption geek and want to play with this, it's open source code, encrypt everything, send it to BigQuery. BigQuery will be able to analyze it without knowing what the data is or what the result is, and you will be able to decrypt results back in at home. It's cool. But yeah. Yeah. It's one of the cool new projects. You can read about the algorithms here, because I don't really understand them, but they are explained. Mathematics.